guys, welcome to Survival Russia. As many of you guys know that on my channel here, I like to show the reality of survival, the reality of outdoorsmanship, and once in a while I like to give some tips and so on. Even I do not really like to tell people what to do and what not to do. I just show what I do, right? But anyway, I stumbled upon a video a little while ago. It was a survival Lily video, and it's called About Saws. And she's demonstrating some saws, and one of the saws she is demonstrating is my go-to saw, the Silky Big Boy 2000, which is an awesome saw. But Lily had some problems with this saw, and you can say basically this video is helping out Survivor Lily, or what we can say, on getting the most out of the Silky Big Boy. Because, of course, it's a pull action and not a push action. It's not a bow saw. It's not a hacksaw, or what we can say. Yeah, it's a little different. So in the video, it was also pointed out that it would most likely cut well for a folding saw. For a folding saw. I don't understand that statement, because, I mean, folding saw, why shouldn't a folding saw be able to cut just as well or even better than a fixed blade saw, for example? I don't understand that. Silky saws, they are definitely among the sharpest and best cutting saws on the market, especially for the outdoorsman. And I'm gonna need this sapling here for later, so let's see how that goes. Pretty fast. The second point was that she was or you were pointing out that it was potentially dangerous because there are no safety mechanism from opening the blade. There's only a safety mechanism when it's locked here, when it's fully open, right? So when storing it in a backpack, it sort of like could be an issue that maybe it opened a little bit and you could cut yourself on it, sort of like. That was anyway your statement or Lily's statement. I don't know if Lily ever gonna watch this video, but anyway, first of all, Silky says that when not in use, it's best to store it in a sheath, and Lily also pointed that out. It's good to store it in a sheath, but there is a thing that we can do, and that is like me, don't store it like this in the backpack, just store it like that, right? So that's pretty easy. But let's move on to the next talking point, because that is a talking point that I can definitely help Survivor Lily out with, how to use a saw correctly, because it has also something to do with safety. She's pointing out that you should not be tempted to push down on the blade while cutting, which is absolutely wrong. The reason for that statement is that Lily was sawing like this here on a round tree stump. Tree stumps are normally round, but and when she cut through, she noticed that the blade, of course, went down here, and the thigh is down here, and that is, of course, not good. I mean, this is a non-favorable working position with any saw, to sit with your thigh down here. But for a folding saw, it's especially not great. So, of course, you should push down on the blade while cutting, because it optimizes the cutting performance. Well, this, of course, means that a person has to have the right working position and the right technique and so on, and all tools take some kind of technique and knowledge on how to operate them, right? So if I want to cut this little piece of pine branch here for fat wood or something like this, or just general firewood, I will, of course, use two hands. So I will press down while pulling, and not so much while pushing. I showed this in an earlier video, but anyway, one way you can operate the saw safer while delimbing a tree trunk, for example, is to just stay on this side here, for example. Or, like I did just before, I had this one between me, Here, I will have a little branch here also between me, so it will never go further than this, right? But you should of course not stand like this. That will not be awesome. All right, so the next potential problem should be that, as you can see, there's a small gap here between the blade and the handle. I use this a lot, and I have other saws with the same feature. It's because it has the curved blade here, right? And I never had an issue with it really, so yeah, maybe it's a safety issue, maybe not. I don't consider it a safety issue. I mean, you have to be careful with all cutting tools, basically, right? So, yeah. But as I mentioned before, it's of course a good idea to press down on the pull and not on the push. Especially if you have to cut a trunk like this, for example. The big boy here will do that easily. And that is a really good thing to be able to do if you are in an emergency survival situation and you need to make yourself a Siberian log fire or something like this. So pull and press, and push and don't press. So yes, of course you should press down on the blade while pulling, and the saw will cut awesomely. But what was said in the video is that you don't really need to push down on the blade because it has this curve here. The curve gives a little bit more bite out here, but it's not really what is designed for. The curve is designed for when you are reaching up high to cut, then you do not have so much force to press on the blade, right, or on the saw while you're pulling, because you're standing like this. So the last bit of the blade here will give a better bite, so to speak, because it's curved. So up here we have some dry spruce branches, and they are of course excellent for starting fires with. So when I'm reaching up here, I of course do not have so much pressing power on the blade, right, or on the saw. But anyway, it took me 3 cuts or 3 pulls. So now I have some more fire starting material. That is always awesome. Spruceum is awesome. But yeah, I can of course reach pretty high with this long saw here, so that's definitely an advantage. So next up, Lily is talking about the ergonomics on the handle here. She do not really like the straight handle, and that the optimal, what you can say, position for your hand when sawing is like this, and not like that, and not like this, and that, and that, but like this. That is kind of true if you have a push cut saw, right? So it's of course important to understand the difference in the sawing technique and so on and so forth, push action saw versus pull action saw, because I'm sure that the Japanese back in the day, hundreds of years ago, would have designed the saw handle here differently if there was a better way to do it. For pull cutting, you can almost see it. This is excellent. It's excellent. Standing like this with it, that is definitely not awesome. But having it like this, and even having it like this, and with another hand on it, that is really awesome. But now I'd like to demonstrate a few techniques on how to actually use the saw, and I would also talk about some safety issues that that Lily completely left out, especially when it comes to bow saws. So let's get it done. It is of course far from favorable and optimal to sit on a small tree stump with a piece of wood and try and cut it like this, right? That is not super awesome. It can be done, but it's not super awesome. So I have lined up a few different ways to demonstrate how I do it, because this is how I did it when I made this fire. One thing you can do is, of course, if you have a push action saw, you can put your piece of wood here, and then you can cut, right? I mean, I know a bow saw supposedly cuts on the pull and push, but you will find out that on the pull, because you're holding the saw and so on like this, it doesn't cut that much. This is a pull action saw, but as you can see, it of course also cuts a little bit on the push. Anyway, for the pull action saw, you can put the log behind here and put your leg here or foot here to stop it from moving too much around. Done. That is one way to make it pretty safe. And as I said, when we are working like this here, I do not have, even I'm pressing down, I don't have the option or possibility that it would all of a sudden slip down here. Then I should be really, really not awesome. If I was cutting out here, it's of course a different matter. But when we are cutting in here, it's pretty safe because you sort of like stop cutting when we are here. And we have a long way to go to even end up over here. What we could do was, of course, to just stand up and do the same. But as you might be able to see down here, I have made a little sawhorse, and that is very, very simple. It's just a log on the ground, and then a stick pointed in one end that have driven into the ground with another stick, actually with this stick, but just like this. And then we have a little device that we can hold our wood in that we want to cut. You can of course make two of these. You can make one over here as well, so it will be supported even better. Then you have a real sawhorse, and it actually works quite well. Let's take a look. And while we are at it, a box saw or bow saw, it has a really bad tendency to jump when you're starting the cut, right? And that means that holding your hand close to where you're starting, that is a very, very dangerous. I actually have had a friend in Denmark, colleague, who cut himself really, really, really bad with a jumping saw that went up here. That was not great at all. I mean, that was stitches and I mean, they were serious, really serious. So the push saw action can be a little bit dangerous. With the pull action, you have, as I said many times, you have really excellent control of what you're doing. You can see how nice the saw is cutting, right? But of course, I would not sit on a Slav squat while I'm cutting firewood, right? So let's get another one on. Make another set over here. And you have a really nice working position and safe also, right? So this is an awesome way to do it. If you have a steady cam, you have the time and all that good stuff. Another way I like to cut wood in the winter when we have really deep snow. The snow is not that deep yet, but that is simply just to lay the log on the ground. You can cut like this. Boom. That is awesome. This is really, really useful if you're just taking down a tree of any size, large or small, and it just lays there on top of 1 meter of snow or something like this. Now, as I said, it's not that deep. It's 40 centimeters or 50 centimeters by now. But then you can simply cut the log, no problem. And it will not bind or anything because it will just lay on this nice pillow of snow. So yeah, there's many advantages to the silky saws and to the big boy especially, because it's not middle-sized and it's not big. I don't know what to call it, but this is really great. And what was mentioned in the video was that Lily would prefer the smaller bow saw of some kind over the Big Boy 2000 here for bushcraft and survival. I think it's a good idea to try and pull these two things apart, or two topics, or what you can call it. I don't even like the bushcraft label. It's just about outdoorsmanship. Well, right? If you say bushcraft and survival, what you mean is outdoorsmanship, but it's actually two different things, because bushcraft, outdoorsmanship, is just us being outdoors and enjoying ourselves and training. Every time we're out, we're training, even when we do not think we're training, right? Survival, though, that is something completely different, because if we are in a survival situation, emergency situation, that is the time where we will find out how good outdoorsmen are we. That is where you have to put all your, what you can say, skill and whatever you've learned into use. And one thing that's important in a survival situation, especially in the winter and so on, is a fire, and to make it fast. And there are no better saw to do that with than the larger and big silky saws, that is for sure. So guys and Lily, if you're watching, I hope you found it informational, and I hope you like the video, and subscribe, bell, like, and all that good stuff. So yeah, guys, until next time, get out and train, get it done, do something awesome, and see you in the next video, guys. Thank you for your time, thank you for your help and support. You're awesome, guys.